Hi everyone, and I hope you're all doing great. So welcome to my next tutorial where I'll be teaching you how to generate a requirements.txt file the correct way. So for those of you that are wondering what on earth is a requirements.txt file, well basically it is a list of all the packages, libraries and modules that you are utilizing within your Django project. Okay, so basically your requirements.txt file is a must, especially if you are deploying your application. So it's very important that you know how to use it properly. All right, so let's get started. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to just create a normal folder here, and I'm going to call it dev. Okay, now we want to make commands within this folder. So I'm going to just search for my command prompt, so my terminal here, and I just want to have access to this folder dev. So to do that, I want to say cd, which means change directory. And first of all, I want to go to my desktop. So now I'm on my desktop here. And now to the folder, I'll just say cd dev. Okay, if you want to clean up your terminal, you can type in the command cls, and this is used to clear your command prompt. So this is very basic level stuff. All right, so now what you want to do is you want to install your virtual environment. So to do that, you will say pip install virtual env. Okay, so this is the command that we need to use to install a virtual environment. Okay, now this is probably one of the only one of the few commands that you should actually set, okay, without being in a virtual environment. Of course, you can't set this in a virtual environment because you need this to set a virtual environment. I know that's a bit of a bit weird to say, a bit fruity, but generally speaking, you shouldn't install packages globally. In this instance, you have no choice, but generally you should always install your packages and libraries within a virtual environment. So go ahead and install your virtual environment package. Okay, I already have it installed, so it will say requirement already satisfied. So let's clear this up. Now let's create a virtual environment. So you'll start off with the command virtual env. And next to that, you're just going to name your virtual environment. So I'm just going to call mine VENV1, which stands for virtual environment 1. And I'm going to create my virtual environment. And there we go, it's been created. Now, what we want to do now is we want to actually activate our virtual environment. So in this case, I'm going to say VENV1. And the reason I'm saying VENV1 is because this is what I chose to name my virtual environment. You may have chosen to have named it something different, but in my case here, mine is VENV1, all right? And then you will say backslash scripts, backslash activate, like so. And you can verify and validate that your virtual environment has been activated if you see it here on the left within parentheses. Now, if you want to deactivate it, I'm running over my words. You would type in your virtual environment name. So in my case, VENV1, backslash scripts, backslash deactivate. Okay, and then you'll no longer see that your virtual environment is active because you won't see it within parentheses and you won't see it all anymore. Okay, so that is how you would activate and deactivate your virtual environment. Okay, now let's clear that up. And what we want to do now is we're going to go ahead and activate it again. Okay, clean it up. And we want to go ahead and install Django. So we can just say pip install Django. Okay, so we are installing it, as you can see, within our virtual environment. So make sure whenever you install a package in Django, that you always install it while your virtual environment is active, because if you don't do that, it's going to be installed globally. But I'll get to locally and globally concepts in a second. So let's just wait for this to install. So I'm just going to wait for this. All right, so we can now see that Django has been installed within our virtual environment along with all of its packages. So we can see here by installing Django, it also had sort of like sub packages, as we can see here, like SQL parse, TZ data, and so on. Now let's go ahead and just clear this up. Okay, now I want to show you something quite interesting to understand the concept between installing packages globally on your system and installing them locally on your within your virtual environment. So let's deactivate, first of all, our virtual environment. So you can just say VENV1 backslash scripts backslash deactivate. Okay, so now we're out of our virtual environment. And I want to now see all of the globally installed packages on my computer. Now, what I mean by this is whenever you say, for example, pip install Django, okay, and you're not in your virtual environment and you just press enter, okay, it's going to be installed globally on your system. Now, as you can see here, I made the mistake in my earlier Django days to install packages globally like that, which is the wrong way to do it. So let's clear this up. And I'm going to now teach you a command here, which is called pip list, okay? And pip list is going to show all of the packages that you have in the specific environment which you're in. So in this case, I'm in my global environment, so globally on my system, and it's going to show me all the packages that I have. In other words, it's going to show all the mistakes I made. As you can see here, it's quite colossal. So this is, of course, not what you want to have. You do not want to install packages like you see, like I have done before, globally on your machine. Okay, this is not what you want to happen, because this basically, in my case, when I started making Django projects early in the beginning, for about the first few projects I made, I just ran pip install and then the package, and this was installed globally. So when I went to generate my requirements.txt file, I literally had this list every time, and it was quite a mess to sort out. Okay, so this shows all of the global packages on my system. Now let me teach you about locally installed packages. So let's say you go into your virtual environment and I activate that. Remember, you need to be in the location of your virtual environment and you need to activate it. Activate it. Okay, so now we are within our virtual environment one here, the one that we just created, and I'm going to say pip list. Now look at the difference here. Okay, so we can now see all of the packages, all right, that are within this virtual environment. So remember, these aren't globally on my system. These are all the packages that are locally within my virtual environment for the project that I'm about to create. Okay, so that is the difference between globally installing packages and installing them within a virtual environment. The best way to do it in programming is for each project that you make, you need to make a virtual environment, and you need to do it this way. So you need to make sure that whenever you say, for example, pip install Django, for example, or pip install Pytes or whichever, make sure you're in your virtual environment for that project where you want that package to be installed, and don't do it globally for every single package. Okay, this is the best way to have some sort of workflow or control flow with your packages. Okay, so just remember that, very, very important to understand that sort of concept. Now, what I want us to do now is generate a requirements.txt file. Now, I want to show you the difference with globally and locally. So let's deactivate this again. So I know, guys, I'm sorry if some of you want me to move a bit faster, but I'm just trying to be a bit as thorough as possible here. So let's say, for example, that we go ahead and create a project now. So I'm just going to now actually put this back on. Okay, actually. And I'm going to say Django dash admin start project, and I'm just going to call this e-commerce. Very simple. So I'm in my project with my virtual environment active, and I'm just going to open this up in Visual Studio Code. So let's just open this up. Okay, there we are. So if it doesn't automatically show up for you, what you can do is simply say file, and you can say open folder. And you can click on that specific folder. So in our case, it's dev. And there we go. Okay. So now let's get straight to it here. So we want to, first of all, deactivate this virtual environment. Okay, so scripts deactivate. Okay, so we're out of our virtual environment. And what I want to do now is show you something. So if you wanted to generate a requirements.txt file, the common command would be pip freeze greater than requirements.txt. That is the general way to do it. But there's a problem here, because if you do it this way, without being in your virtual environment, what's going to happen is you're going to get a list of all of your packages, and this is all of your global packages which I showed you earlier, which have been installed on your system, and this is not what you want. So the safest way to do this, without any drama or any issues, is to do this. So make sure that you're in your projects directory, for example, and you can just activate your virtual environment. Okay. Now, the safest way I want you to do this is to say pip freeze dash dash, remember two separate dashes, local greater than symbol requirements.txt. Now, technically, you could say pip freeze greater than requirements.txt without local and still be in your virtual environment, but there have been cases when it still happens to install all of the global dependencies. So the safest way is to use either dash dash local or I believe it's dash dash L, but let's go with local, to install all of the packages within your virtual environment. So go ahead and make sure, first of all, you're in your virtual environment and that you say pip freeze dash dash local greater than requirements.txt and enter. Now let's take a look now. Okay, and let's have a look. And now we can see all of the packages that are within this virtual environment of our project. Okay, so that is the better way to, go ahead and create a requirements.txt file for your project. Okay, and not to go ahead and install all of the packages on your system. Because this requirements.txt file is very important. As you've seen, probably some of you have seen my videos or my courses. Okay, in everything that we do, if we, for example, Dockerize a Django image, or if we were to deploy to Heroku or deploy to Elastic Beanstalk, we will always need this requirements.txt file. And it's, the best way in programming to make sure that you do things the right way. And this is definitely the right way to do it, to make sure that you are, generating a requirements.txt file for your specific Django project and not one with a lot of random, for example, packages that you have in your requirements.txt file. So this is something very important to learn, and it took me a long time to figure this out, even though it's so simple, but it's definitely something that's very important, and it's really a useful thing to do. Okay, so that's it, guys. That's how you would go ahead and generate a requirements.txt file the right way. For those of you that are also interested in learning a bit more about requirements.txt and virtual environments, there is a package called pip-env. So I'll actually type this here for you. So it's called pip-env. And what I would suggest you do, for those of you that are curious to learn a little bit more about virtual environments, I would recommend you just putting this in Google and giving this a search if you want to know more and learn a bit further about virtual environments. It's not necessary, but it is something quite cool and interesting to look at, because what you can do is you can install a package called pip-env, which creates something called a pip file for all of your packages and dependencies. Now, this is another sort of mechanism in which you can generate a requirements.txt file and also a pip lock file, I believe. Okay, so just out of curiosity for you guys that are wondering about learning more. Okay, so that's it, guys. I hope this was helpful to you. So this is how you generate the requirements.txt file the right way within your virtual environment. All right, so that's it, guys. Thank you so much.